Hello, good afternoon, everybody. And it's my pleasure to start our My Leadership Journey series today. Today's our kickoff. And today we're very pleased, I'm very pleased, and I think you will be as well, to introduce Dr. Anthony Chow. Anthony is the new director of the iSchool in San Jose, which when you hear some of the statistics about that school, it's like, what? How many? That's great. Well, Anthony, welcome. I know you're a returning California person. You were in the Bay Area for a few years, but I'm going to give everybody a little brief update about you. But I understand there's much more that we don't know because things are not always published in your professional bio. I learned some things when we were chatting earlier about you, but I won't say. Anthony, you recently came from University of North Carolina at Greensboro, where you're an associate professor. And by the way, you were just elected to the CLA board, California Library Association. Congratulations. And
thank you so much.
CLA is our physical agent for this project, and we're really happy to be doing this project on behalf of CLA as well. You went to San Francisco State. You got a BS there in developmental psychology. From there, you went to Florida State. You got a MS in educational psychology. Now you have a PhD in instrumental systems design. I hope you're going to tell us what that is. I
think instructional systems design, yeah. Instructional, okay. Yeah.
Okay. So, your teaching areas of expertise, according to what you said in your bio, web design, leadership, management, and with an expertise in online teaching. So, Anthony, you've been here since July. You're a hard man to catch up with. You're busy. You're running on the run back and forth, North Carolina here. Hopefully you're settled in now. Are you?
No, I'm living in my brother's house in Saratoga. As you know, the price of home values are a little different than pretty much the rest of the world. And so we're taking our time to look for the right place. But the good news is my brother is here in Saratoga. So it's a easy 15-minute drive right now. So,
well, yeah. Great. Good luck with that. And good luck to your brother and his family.
Thank you. I'll probably need some tips, Martin.
So, Anthony, this session is really about leadership. This is part of the Developing Leaders in California Libraries program that Christine mentioned earlier. And we have a cohort of 40 people this year who are getting some tips on leadership. One of the key components of that certainly is to be able to hear from others who have gotten themselves into a leadership situation, a leadership position of leadership, sometimes reluctantly, sometimes it just happens, and sometimes it's very deliberate. So we're interested in hearing about your leadership journey, your professional leadership journey. So Anthony, could you briefly describe your path and how did you end up getting to your position at the iSchool?
Sure. Yeah, I would say there's a saying that our leader, or the question, are leaders made or are they born? And I think that I believe leaders are made. However, there is, I think, a predisposition to leadership based on maybe family markers and tradition and culture that maybe you're given as a young child. So I will say that. I think both. So my leadership journey really began probably in middle school when the coach playing football, the coach gave me the ball and said, "You are now going to be the quarterback." and I say that because I, starting then until now, have been asked to be in a leadership role because I think one of my talents is passion. Right. So whenever I participate in something, I really commit myself to it. I really enjoy it. And I think when you're passionate about something and you enjoy something, there's a level of performance, a level of commitment that makes you a natural target for leadership. Right. Now, with that being said, the trick, as you know, Martin, is that ironically the very skill sets that are that cause you to be selected as a leader is actually the very skill sets you shouldn't use as a leader, right? And we're going to talk more about that. But the bottom line is so starting there in middle school, and it just kind of continued. I was fortunate to be offered a leadership positions pretty much from that point on, and most of the organizations that I participated in. And I think it was the same formula, Martine, that when I do things, I commit to them. And I typically, therefore, are the last person standing as far as, Anthony will do it. and that pretty much has led me to where I am now today, because ultimately, although my background is on the graduate levels, educational psychology and instructional design, and you ask what that is, it's basically building performance systems to improve or increase human performance, right? And so instructional design began in the military in World War II, and it's basically developing systems in which we can accelerate and make as efficient as possible instruction so that we can teach the skills, the KSAs, knowledge, skills, and abilities, and attitudes needed for as high performance as possible, right? And so you tie all that together, you really get a perfect fit in terms of my passion for helping people and library and information science. So make a long story short, I worked as the coordinator of online learning for Florida State School of Information, fell in love with the field of especially information science. When I got my PhD in instructional systems design, I was hired at UNC Greensboro's Department of Library and Information Science, because instructional design, information technology, instructional technology, information science really are all connected together, right? So same thing when I got to UNCG, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, passionate, Martine, I was asked to be a leader over and over and over. So I got an email from the dean of the School of Education that asked me to be the faculty assembly chair at the college level or school level, right? And then I ended up being very active at the university level, right? And so I developed the reputation. So when UNCG needed a chair of the faculty senate, lo and behold, the provost and the current chair of the faculty senate reached out to me and asked if I would be interested. Right. And I had to think about it, Martine. I had to think about it, because becoming the chair of the entire faculty at UNCG was a bit intimidating, to be honest. Yeah. And the question I asked myself is, would I be a good fit for that?
That line, have you ever said no thanks?
Yes. Yes. I definitely have said no thanks, because if you already have a good job, then you have to say no to other opportunities that come up. And ironically, probably should turn off the recording now, I've already had several offers since I became the director of the high school that I've had to say no to, which of course I should. So anyway, to make a long story short, I think I got an email from Dr. Main asking if I would be interested. And I think that is the foundation of I believe being a good leader, which is it depends. But in my journey, I've never really sought leadership. Mm-hmm. What I have done is sought with passion good outcomes for things that I believe in, right? And I think it's that conviction that then leaders like yourself, Martine, say, well, this guy might be a good leader, right? And so I think that's why they reached out to me. I wasn't looking. But once I started looking at everything the iSchool had to offer, not to mention it's in the beautiful Bay Area and in California, it just was a perfect fit pretty much across the board. So
I picked out a line in your bio, and I think you could chat a little bit about this. It has to do with something to the effect that leadership is contributing to the team effort. And talk about team leadership and how that is or isn't different than the passion that you talked about.
Yeah. So what I've learned about leadership is that oftentimes, say, for example, when we talk about vision, we talk about establishing a vision for the organization and selling the organization on that vision. And I want to refine that. In my experience, it's not about selling anything to the organization. It's about working with your organization to understand what its priorities are and then representing that. Right. Mm-hmm. Again, going back to being a quarterback, right? Leadership is both you get all the credit and you get all the criticism, right? So in football, you know, I might throw a touchdown pass, but I'd probably say half the touchdown passes Martin and I threw, I never saw, because my face was in the dirt with some 300 pound guy on top of me, right? And it hurt. It hurt a lot, right? And so when we talk about team leadership, it means understanding the strengths of your team and working within those boundaries. Because what I learned very quickly is that, and this is my point at the first question, is that what I have as talents, what I consider in terms of work ethic, my passion, my understanding, my expertise, will be very different than the rest of your team. And to expect them to have the same work ethic and skill set and is incorrect, right? And so what I learned, and what most new leaders learn the hard way, is that that if you try to have it my way or the highway, it's not going to work, right? And so that's what I mean by that, Martin. That whatever team I'm part of, I learn about it. We call it the platinum rule. It's not the golden rule. Don't do onto others as I would do, but actually treat others as they want to be treated. And right. So every team is unique in its potential. And so as a leader, you must figure that out and then fit into that team so that it's successful.
So I enjoyed reading your article that you penned with Ashley Conte, a 360-degree view. And in that article, you talked about three characteristics that seem to overlap in the literature regarding leadership. You talked about agreeableness, task-oriented behaviors, and embracing people's strengths and individual needs. So you touched a little bit on that just now. Are those quality still relevant for 2021? We seem to be in a different era today.
100%. Yeah, that's a formula, I think, for success in general, Martin. Agreeableness. As a leader, as a teammate, as a partner, there are going to be a lot of things that you don't agree with. There are going to be a lot of things where that's not how I would do it. And there are a lot of, and there would be a lot of situations where people will actually be rude to you. But the question is, how do you respond, right? And so what I've learned, and I think all really successful leaders have learned, is to let it go. Most importantly, Martin, it's the relationship and the positivity that carries the day, right? So if I'm working with colleagues and we have a major conflict and I respond with negativity, then I essentially cut off a strong relationship in the future with that individual, right? And so I think that it's a real success tactic to be agreeable almost exclusively, right? And when things are of conflict, you want to try to not focus on it, certainly learn from it, but not focus on it, and definitely don't make it personal and never sever that relationship. When I teach leadership, Martin, I use the example of road rage, right? So if somebody is exhibiting road rage to you, right, the question is, what are you going to do about it? And if you react with rage back to them, then you've exacerbated already a bad situation. And then on top of that, we all know that when we have conflict and we get angry, it's tiring, it's exhausting, you're not focused on getting the job done, you're stooping down to the level of the person. And then probably the most important thing, Martin, with that is that people that are seeking conflict or being rude, in the end, really, it is their issue, right? They're really having a bad day, or they're trying to take a shot at you, or whatever it might be. Yep. But if you respond negatively, it's a lose-lose proposition. And then as far as task oriented, one of the fluidity of leadership and management, it kind of comes together oftentimes, right? And so task oriented means, as the leader, the head leader, it's your job to make sure things are getting done. Now, you don't want to micromanage. However, at the end of the day, you're responsible for the outcome. So if the outcomes are not where you need it to be, you need to be task-oriented enough to understand, hey, guys, we really need to get this done, right? So someone's got to be watching the hen house, Martin, right? And the leader, ultimately the leader is responsible. They get the credit and they get the criticism. So
Anthony, you've been around the block a couple of times. And I know I've been in a situation or two in my career where, you know, it's just, it ain't working. Okay. That leadership thing and the kind of the taking the high road approach. Have you ever been in a situation where you've said, hey, I'm going to walk away. This is not going to, I can't lead in this situation. I can't be part of a team.
Have I ever left? I would say yes and no. I'll say no and yes. So when I think about professionally, I don't think I've ever left a company for that reason. But with that being said, I'm married to my high school sweetheart, Martine. I like to settle. When I'm settled, I settle, right? I'm not someone that looks for other opportunities, again, because I like to dig in and really, but with that being said, for volunteer or professional associations, there are times where, you know, we only have so much time in the day, right? And so there are certainly some associations, organizations I just said, you know, it's not really working, and I have better things to do with my time, right? And so I stopped contributing. But the other thing, Martina, I would say about that question is, I think, at least what I've learned, is that even when things are really bad, for example, academia, if you take the high road and you continue working hard. So one of the best advice that I received from a mentor is to basically say, ignore the small things, focus on your work, and that will speak for itself. Right. And I've taken that. And again, being working hard and being kind to people. I think those two things, Martine, are the two most as of right now. Two recommendations that I would say are the most important. And the reason for that is because even if you're under bad leadership, Martine, bad leadership usually speaks for itself as well. Right. So the question you have to ask yourself is, how long is that bad leader going to last before they're gone? And my observation is that when bad leadership is in display, it doesn't last very long. So,
yep, I hear you, Anthony. So listen, we have about 40 people in this cohort now. I think many of them are on the Zoom session. What advice do you have for people who are new to the profession in terms of their leadership? And what areas do you, would you recommend to them focusing on? And I'm thinking in a couple of dimensions. One is their own personal career advancement as one. And secondly, and I think you've touched a lot upon on this, and has to do with kind of their human side and being the kind of person that people want to follow, if that's the right way to characterize it. So on the career side, what kind of recommendations do you have? There's some very practical things that people have done, you know, to try to advance their career, but what has worked for you, or what advice would you have for them?
Yeah, I would start with, I'm not a big believer in looking for leadership. You want leadership to look for you, right? And so what do I mean by that? A good leadership tenet, I believe, is to have jobs that you are passionate about and that you're good at. And what you don't want to do is follow the ladder, where we call it the Peter principle, mm-hmm. where you get promoted to your point of incompetence, right? So my suggestion to young leaders or potential leaders is to commit yourself to doing really good work in anything that you do. Be hardworking and kind to other people. And it can be hard, but being kind to other people consistently. When it's your time to lead, you will be given that opportunity. Now, the other thing I would say, Martine, I think you've seen this too. As I get older, it's a lot easier to lead because all of the leaders are around our generation, right? That's also important because when I was younger, I was very intimidated, right? But my youngest now is in college. I've lived a good life and I've learned a lot from that. And so now for me, leading is easier because I'm talking to contemporaries, right? Not talking to people with much more. I mean, of course, there are, other generations above us. But I find that for me, my age group is typically, you know, in positions of leadership. My other advice would be to get involved. So tied to that, especially professional organizations. In fact, my leadership story, Martine, really came from, I wasn't in a formal position of leadership, but because of organizations, I did rise to leadership. So I ended up being the chair, co-chair of advocacy for the North Carolina Library Association. So everybody got to know me, but I didn't do it because of that. I did it because I care about libraries, and I cared enough about libraries to do something about it, right? To write those emails, to make those phone calls, to go to Washington, D.C., to go to Raleigh. And if you are, if you think you have the mettle to be a leader, you've got to prove it, right? And prove it not as a leader, but as someone that can be relied upon. And more importantly, for your own self, that you care enough, you're passionate enough to be doing it at odd hours, 3 a.m, 5 a.m, you know, after the kids go to bed, whatever it might be, then you know you're in the right field. And honestly, the other aspect of that leadership is again, leadership will find you. So even if you don't pursue leadership, even if you're just focused on a particular area, you still may end up being in a leadership position later on because you're the last one standing, right? Mm-hmm. And you are such an expert in the field, everybody is going to respect that. And then you kind of fold into a natural leadership position. And I do believe too, that that happens with age and expertise, right? In other words, you don't necessarily have to look for leadership. If you really love something, you're really good at it, you're really passionate about it, very quickly in the future, you're going to be asked to be a leader. And it will find you, just like that email that I got from Dr. May. Wasn't right. Looking for it, they found me.
Well, it's interesting you put it into kind of generational terms, because the older that I get, and the, you know, I've been around the block a few times myself, it seems to be, not only do the leadership opportunities look for you or find you, but the opportunities seem to be the leadership challenge, if you will, seems to be a little bit easier because I have this experience and I'm able, I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, I know it all. That's not my point. My point is that as you mature through the profession, as you mature through your career, there are things that not only you know based on your experience, but you also know and can utilize that experience to be able to provide a leadership role, to provide some support for people who need that kind of support. Let's switch a little bit and talk a little bit about the iSchool. So you've been there not quite 5 months now, is that right?
That's right, yeah, 4 months, yep.
So what role do you want to see the iSchool play in preparing students to become the next generation of leaders?
Yeah, I think once I got to know the iSchool a little bit better, I'm even more in love with it. And the reason for that is because of the diversity, where we have students in all 50 states. We've got faculty and staff all across the country. I realize that we, Martine, have a leadership responsibility. So I appreciate you sitting at our first Hispanic Heritage Celebration Symposium. And we have taken that as a blueprint, and we are going to do that with many other Heritage Months, right? And so what do I mean by that? Well, we currently have 2,400 MLS students. And so
2,400 MLS students
in all 50 states, right?
Is that the most of any iSchool, by the way?
I think it's the most, I think it's the largest program in the world, honestly, but I'm still looking at by far the nation, but I believe the world.
Incredible. Now,
it's incredible. Yeah. And it really is a tribute to those that have come before me. Dr. Hirsch, Sandy Hirsch, Dr. Linda Main, Dr. Kent Haycock, all of those people have given me or built this amazing organization. So when we have 2,400 students all across the country, and actually some international students as well, many of them are libraries, Martine, we actually can then impact the field by providing good programming, right? So that's one of the reasons why I thought of the Hispanic Heritage Month. We are, San Jose State is a historically Hispanic serving institution. We should, and we are, but we should continue to be the purveyor of quality, high quality programming, best practices on how to serve the Hispanic Latinx community, right? Not to say that we exclusively, but we've got you. We've got all the people that are part of the Hispanic Latinx community that I want to learn from, that everybody else should be learning from too, right? And so that's definitely one of my plans, is equity, diversity, inclusion. The next one's technology. So I'm a technology geek, self-educated, but most importantly, technology improves the efficiency, the effectiveness, connectedness, communication. It does so many things for so many people across so many levels. And so certainly technology from an information library and information science standpoint continues to empower us, right? So Martine, it's so exciting that libraries are being used more, not less, because of digital access, right? That door now has been kicked wide open. And Martine, you know, with unfortunately COVID, but post-COVID with online learning and hybrid learning and high flex learning and hotspots and broadband, and libraries are more important than ever, right? And so technology is another, we are the public library, public university of Silicon Valley. And so with that moniker comes, again, great expectations. And so certainly with my expertise in technology, we are going to be a leader in that as well. So just like I said, Martine, with the symposiums, I've already purchased robots and drones and hologram material and all sorts of things, right? Because our dean is very supportive of that. And we are going to do a technology channel. We're going to test it. We're going to poke at it. We're going to look around at model libraries. And if we think it's a value, we're going to put it on the channel to provide that as a access point to all libraries in the country, right?
And that so sounds exciting. That yeah. sounds very exciting.
Yep. And then last thing would be e-learning. So we already, we're all on, so by being the largest MLIS program in the world, all of it's online, and being the largest graduate program in the CSU system, we are experts in online e-learning. And so that would be the last thing, is that we must continue pushing the envelope in the online e-learning world, high quality, right? So one of the criticisms of the iSchools, are you just a diploma mill? And the answer unequivocally is no. That the average teaching evaluation for our faculty is a 4.5.
Wow.
Right. Out of five. Right. And if you're not a good instructor with the iSchool, then we're not going to retain you. Right. And so the bottom line is we have, Dr. Main and Dr. Hirsch have developed a system that breeds high quality, really high quality. Right. And so so we're going to continue pushing that envelope to make that even more so.
So, you know, in my experience in a kind of the working in libraries, and I wonder if this is similar for you in academia, you have the people who are very interested in traditional library services. So where's my children's materials? Where's my, you know, preschool story time? What happened to the reference collection? All those kinds of things that, you know, I'm showing my age here, but, you know, the generations or so, and people who are now having kids, they're looking for more traditional. So how does that translate for you at the iSchool for the students who are coming for that kind of information and knowledge?
Oh, yeah, that's a great point. I think that those all still are very germane, right? So I think when we talk about the digital world and information age and technology, those are just different means to the same end, right? So everybody wants high quality information. Everybody wants high quality children's programming. Everybody wants high quality children's literature. But Martine, the same rules apply, but now instead of just offering a story time, now you might need to digitize it and put it on YouTube Live as well. Why? Because you might have 15 people in front of you, but you may have 1,000 or whatever, 100 more online, right? And so so I guess I call it the plus one. The field of library information science is still the same. Equalize the playing field, provide quality information, organize information, share information, educate the public on what we can offer, right? So those are all the same. Now you, but technology, my message to all aspiring or current librarians is definitely immerse yourself in it, because it empowers you to do even more, right? The question you want to ask yourself if you don't like technology is, what if you could reach one more patron? What if you could do it in a way that would open the door to patrons we don't have, which has happened, Martine, mm-hmm. right? So that's what I always tell students, is that You know, again, technology is scary to a lot of people if you don't understand it. But like anything else, the question you want to ask yourself is, how far are you willing to go to serve your patrons?
Right.
Are you willing to take the lumps to learn technology for the sake of your patrons? And I think, of course, all good librarians are going to say, heck yes. And that's that's where good instruction occurs, right? We're going to teach you, or like other LS programs and programs like that you run, the leadership program, right? Where we're going to provide that pathway as easily and painlessly as possible. It's still going to be painful, right? Learning things is a full contact sport, but we're going to be there every step of the way.
So you're touching on a little bit of this. My next question has to do with kind of what excites you about the future of our profession. Are we headed in the right direction? And I'm thinking of the practitioners, not necessarily the schools where you get the skill sets and the knowledge.
Yeah, we are headed in the right direction. I had the privilege of talking to Chris Brown, a 2010 graduate of the iSchool, who's now the commissioner of the Chicago Public Libraries, right? And he told me about his public library, 81 branches, Martin, right? So a lot of his branches are in some of the toughest neighborhoods in the country.
Yes.
And so that library is a beacon of safety for otherwise a very dangerous neighborhood, right? So that's exciting to him. And it's exciting to us because libraries still serve as that safe haven for people that need it, right? And that's not, of course, the only people that they serve. But so, yes, I think the very location is definitely very, continue to be very important. And now, with that being said, tying to some of your questions earlier, you've got to have tradition with innovation and growth, right? So what he told me is that the needs of the patrons are changing, Martin, right? So yes, they have information needs, but they might also need social service needs. Right. Or, you know, instead of getting frustrated with the loud adolescents, you might accept that as that's who they are, and then try to find ways in which to connect with them at their level, the platinum rule, right? And then on top of that, maybe it's not just information needs you're trying to meet. Maybe it's just to serve as a sounding board, or to connect them with services that might help them break out of a cycle, right? So a lot of, whenever I talk to librarians that serve youth, bullying, suicidal tendencies, abuse at home, right? This is of course controversial, right? A lot of librarians say, should we be getting involved in that? And my response is yes and no. We're not supposed to be doing it, but what we are supposed to be doing is connecting them to resources that can help them, right? And we should be assertive about that, not haphazard. Right. And so when we look at our diverse, and this is just public libraries, of course, but when we look at our diverse clientele, we have to be even more fundamentally, that interview, we've got to understand what their needs are. Because the diversity of those needs continue to be, or are probably greater than ever, right? Because we've got smartphones and tablets and, you know, the COVID, of course. So, you know, as you know, mental health is a huge issue due to COVID. So there's, we've got global warming. You've just got so many evolving things. The libraries will continue to be the bastion of quality information, but we have to make sure that we're meeting the needs of our patrons to stay relevant.
Along those lines, there are a lot of unmet needs. And I remember talking to Chris early on, Chris Brown, when he started as commissioner, and he told me that he had been out at one of the housing projects. I used to work in Chicago at the Chicago Public Library myself, and I had a couple of the housing projects in as one of my branches, right? And Chris came back from one of his visits there. He was deliberate, you know, in the first, I forget, 90 days, he was going to visit all 82 branches, and he did. He did. But he came back with this idea about, you know, there was a shortage of where to get fresh food and produce in the neighborhood. And mm-hmm. he wanted to partner with some of the farmers markets to have the library space used for that purpose, as well as the traditional role. So you're right, there are a lot of unmet needs that when you think about it, we don't necessarily have to have the garden, but we could have the space where the gardeners and others can come in and bring the resources. Another one I was going to tell you about, I'm very excited. Last year, the Developing Leaders program, there were some projects folks worked on. And one that seems to be getting a lot of traction right now is a reentry program for people who are released from prison. And how is the library prepared to meet their needs? And, you know, maybe even before they are de-incarcerated, to be able to, you know, hey, the library's, you know, half a block away or a mile away. And, you know, here's some things you can get. Here's some social services that are available through our website, et cetera, et cetera. So there's always going to be not only the traditional, you know, users who maybe have their preschool kids and ready for, you know, preschool time, but there also are going to be those who have unmet needs that we haven't really scratched the surface on. So things like that. And gosh, I don't know how you would do this, but in your role in academia, there seems to be, it would be wonderful to find some way to connect some of those kind of community aspirations with what students learn in school, in the iSchool. I'm not sure how you would do that, if it's a relationship with the social welfare school, or, you know, school social welfare, or other ways to do it. But it seems to me that there's, it doesn't take too much imagination to think about areas where there's unmet needs that we can just be more creative about.
Yeah, Martina, I completely agree. In fact, you'll enjoy this. So tying it full circle, that is the very goal of instructional design. So the way instructional design, some people call it backwards design, you understand what the quality, what the ideal performance might look like, and then you understand what skills and competencies are needed, and then you back that into the curriculum, right? So 100%, and actually, I did see a question, so I'll get to your question in a second, but in the end, that is certainly one of the goals for the iSchool, right? Is to make sure that we're relevant by talking to leaders like yourself, to Chris. I had the privilege of talking to Greg yesterday and several other leaders constantly, right? And that's part of my job as the director of the iSchool, is to have those conversations, yes, Bring it back to the school and the faculty so that our students can benefit from it. So, because the bottom line is, disruption, right? That term is overused now, but it's so true, right? So I was at an instructional design conference in Chicago, and we talked about the fact that we believe that we could always design good instruction to meet the needs of the learners, but the environment of learning and work is disrupted, right? We don't really know what that looks like anymore. It's not traditional. Like this morning before the retreat, I had my brother's cat walk across the keyboard and scratched and I had a little tail coming across. But that's kind of the world. I mean, how many kids and dogs have we seen in our meetings, right? But I think it's good. I really think it's good. Most of us accept it, because you know what? Pets are our family too, right? And I do believe, I mean, the research will probably come out, I can only imagine the productivity, Martine, the candor, the honesty, the conversations that are different because we have our dog by our feet, or we have our kids right there, right? So it's a very fascinating time. And absolutely, Martine. That's part of the, I think, excitement of our field, is that we are so empowered to do so many different things. So let's get to the, or should we get to the questions?
Yeah. Yes, we have a question in here from Peggy, or it's maybe a comment. She talked about partnerships with local county jails. Did you want to talk a little bit more about that, Peggy? Do you want to ask a question there?
No, I have a lot of thoughts on that too.
All right, go ahead.
I think the answer is 100% we need to do that. So I actually, ironically, you asked that, Peggy, because I was talking to a correction officer the other day, and she explained to me how, and I just talked to the state librarian, Greg Lucas, yesterday about this. Just like schools, the superintendent or the warden really has a great autonomy over their libraries, right? Are they staffing it? Do you have a licensed librarian? What about the collection, et cetera, et cetera? So yes, absolutely, Peggy. I believe we've got to really connect these prison libraries with the wonderful work that their counties, our public library systems are already doing, right? And for several reasons, right? Just like school libraries, without that network, without that support, without being plugged into the innovation, you're isolated, right? And of course, you know, by definition, that's also for you know, strategically because you're in a jail. But the bottom line is that when and Peggy, you probably know this. Depending on which study you read, 65 to 70% of those incarcerated are functionally illiterate.
Right.
Right. So, boy, is that an opportunity for libraries? Adult illiteracy. Right. And when we think about being illiterate, you can imagine what life would be like if you're illiterate. Right. That means you can't learn because and therefore, you know, your options are limited. So 100% agree. Yes. Yeah, absolutely, Peggy. We need to be in juvenile hall, too. Absolutely. So I think this is all ties well, Martine, with I think most of us that are in library because we love to help people. Right. And so the opportunities are so immense. And I do think so, Peggy, stay tuned, because I do think that's the, you know, Greg, state librarian, did say that was a priority of his. Right. And now I'm on the board of CLA and the director of the iSchool. We all agree. So let's work together on trying to, try to centralize a little bit more. Right. So instead of it just being the warden's decision, maybe we could be a little more strategic with what we can do with a very captive audience, right? So
I want to encourage other folks to submit questions into the chat box or the Q&As. We have this great opportunity here to hear from Dr. Chow, his experience. He's got some great ideas about what we should or shouldn't be doing. Well, he didn't say what we shouldn't be doing, but I think the opportunities are endless. Well, by the way, is there something we shouldn't be doing, Anthony?
Shouldn't be doing. Well, I would say, have you ever been to the Hunt Library, Martine?
The Hunt?
Yeah, the Hunt Library, the engineering
in North
library.
Carolina?
Yeah, NC State.
Yes, it's beautiful.
Yeah. So I would say that reflects this comment, which is, so what shouldn't we be doing? I think we should not be running libraries or defining libraries based completely on the past, right? So those of you that haven't heard of the Hunt Library, the director basically was given a gift. So the state of North Carolina said they wanted to build this library named after a former governor. So what that means is a humongous budget, right? And so she went and talked to the faculty. She went and talked to the students and asked them, well, what, you know, doing a good needs assessment environmental scan. And so what she got back from the students is, let's make it fun. Let's have, we want to use a library for studying. We want to use a library for group space. Print material was not as important, right? I know the traditional ones of us but think about it. And academics, most of the textbooks are not print anymore, right? They're digital. So whether we like it or not, it is really the case. So what happened is the Hunt Library, they got a book robot, right? So but we can't afford that. But what they did do is they recognized those trends. They listened to their users. And then one of the requests, Martine, was, can you please get rid of the uncomfortable wooden chairs, right? Because we want to study, because we want to read, can you make it relaxing and comfortable, right? And so what she said is the director went to the catalog, approved vendors, and chose the craziest, most comfortable furniture that she could find. So all gone are all the traditional wood. In its place is fun, exciting furniture. Now, what does that do? Well, what it does is it makes it a destination place, Martine, right? Right. They've got coffee over here. And of course, if you had $130 million, which is how much they had, you have an internationally renowned architect building it. So it's a beautiful space, natural lighting, and the whole design is designed to be relaxing, beautiful. You can stay as long as you want. And then at its core, high-end technology, Martine. So at its core, the mixed-use space debate, right? So they have closed-in conference room after study room after conference room. And it's a really a beautiful amalgamation of mixed use space. So I think that's probably the one thing I would say, Martin, is be user community centered. Do not insist on being traditional in many cases. Now, we don't want to design our services in libraries completely based on the community's desires, but we have to make sure that we stay relevant and continue to evolve and change. So I would say to take this to the its conclusion, always be talking to the community. Right. Never assume you know what they want. And because we know the ethnicity and race is also evolving and changing too. So you can never assume you know what the community wants. So
I remember when I visited that library, what really knocked me off my feet was the virtual lab where you go in and they're doing all these things on this huge screen where you were like in a submarine or you're on the ocean. It was like, you could almost get seasick watching them, but it was just incredible. And, you know, I'm thinking about, you touched briefly on this, you know, sometimes, you didn't say it this way, but sometimes our responsibility might be to push the envelope a little bit, right? Because maybe people don't have the opportunity to see, you know, I remember back in the day, people talked about, well, we're going to have a petting zoo in the library. Well, what do you mean a petting, a technology petting zoo? Oh, okay. So people can come in and take a look and see how it works. And they'd have, you know, people who were knew how to use the equipment. And it's just like, that makes very good sense. You know, it's like, yeah, that the connection, especially in some communities where, my God, you know how much an iPad costs? You know how much a tablet costs? It's like, I don't even know if I can afford one. Maybe give me a chance to see if I like it and how it works. And, you know, so those kinds of ideas, there's new envelopes and there's new horizons to push out there. And, you know, an old bird like me, you know, being in this profession, it's hard to let go because there are so many wonderful things that are happening. And, you know, I'm always trying to figure out, are there ways for us to leverage that in some way that we can increase our value in the community? Because, you know, ultimately it's about, when people are, and I've been involved with these before, when people are going to the polls to vote for a library bond or vote for a tax measure for the library, you want them to know that they're getting value for their investment. And libraries aren't free. They are free in the kind of access point of view, but they're not free in terms of, you know, building the structures and buying the collections and paying for the staff. And so anyway, this is supposed to be about you. I'm sorry, Anthony.
I think that's fantastic. And I think, not only do I agree, I'll say this, Martin, to kind of support what you just said. I'm a big believer, and I know the traditionalists were going to roll their eyes, but we want to do the unlibrary to get people that don't use the library to the library. So, and let me explain that. So I would say have both the real petting zoo, Martin, and the technology petting zoo. Why? Because as you all know, there is a core set of users that use your library. But then very oftentimes there's a larger core that doesn't use the library, right? And we talk about stereotypes all the time, Martin. And it's one of those, you don't know what you don't know, right? So like all stereotypes, the stereotypes for libraries are painfully bad, right? And painfully negative. And if you don't use libraries, well, how are you going to know what a modern library looks like, right? So I'm a big believer, and this is a county manager. I used to do a lot of strategic planning. So last year, county manager said, look, I do not care how you get patrons in the door. But what I'll tell you is as your patron door count increases, I'm going to give you more money. Right. And he said, so I don't care what it takes, whatever it takes, get them in the door. And I can guarantee you when you ask for more money, I'm going to give you more money. Right. And of course that's my point is, so yes, Martin, we should be doing things actually very unlibrary, like to get the unlibrary people. But here's the thing too, what I'm saying is that we do want to offer those traditional services, Martin. We want to continue doing that by all means, but we've got to do very innovative things to get that group of non-users to our library, right? Because we know how much we can help them. Right.
Yep. So, there's a lot of competition out there for people's time. We have a question here from our good colleague, Melinda Cervantes. Did you see that, Anthony?
I did. Yes. So I take it, Melinda, you're a high school student. I I do believe we have a course that at least talks about that, but let's stay in touch because I don't know that much about our humongous curriculum. Dr. Main would probably be able to answer that better. With that being said, Melinda, I am now going to be offering advocacy internships every semester. If our curriculum doesn't have it, then you could always take a special topics course or request to create a course on your own, right? But yes, that is a great point, Melinda. Actually, you won't be surprised to know that pretty much all the state librarians have said the exact same thing, that part of the traditional skill set of librarians has to be how to work with and how to advocate and how to work with the folks that you're going to see. In fact, Chris Brown, Martine, said that too, that he said he wished he had more preparation because, you know, he said in the Chicago public libraries, literally, they have a budget hearing. He goes, so he literally goes to that hearing and gets grilled, right? Grilled by you know, this circle of decision makers. So yeah, no, it's a great. Okay. Well, excellent. Melinda, feel free to reach out to me if you like, but I think that's a very important skill. So, yeah.
I thought for a minute that Melinda had gone back to school.
Let's see, I have a real petting zoo, Peggy. Yeah. No, I'm, you know, the studies are out there, Peggy, and I do, you know, here's a prediction. I predict that we're going to have a spike in overall age in our country because of this whole being around pets thing, right? So the research has shown that people that have pets live longer. I really do think, given you know, our expanded time with our pets, that we might see that. So anyway, Peggy, yes, I agree. I love reading the dogs and ponies and Peggy, yes, in particular, what I really like about your point is that who doesn't like animals, right? So for those kids that aren't coming, for those families that aren't coming to libraries, you know, pets, zoos, horses, those things are kind of naturals to get them in the door, right? And then when you get them in the door, then you have plenty of books about pets and horses and, right? And then if we can make that connection, like, you know, that's how we build the love of reading, right? Make that connection to something they're into. Oh, I get it now, right? The love of reading is not about thou shall, but it's actually to learn more about stuff that we love, right? And that is what we want to do. So forgive me one second. I've got a runny nose. Excuse me.
We have a question, Anthony. I think you can still hear me from Yolande.
Yeah.
question about plans for training new librarians in disaster recovery. Do you see the question there?
Let's see. Do I see the question? I don't see the question, but let me answer
it. Let me read it for you. Because I might have missed it. But she said, can you talk a bit about any plans to train new librarians in disaster recovery, emergency services that many libraries are performing now, including the importance of facilities management and capital improvements to maintain and improve infrastructure?
My first response is Martine's going to take care of that through his training program. That is a great question. I do believe that a lot of county governments are doing that, where they're establishing kind of the process and protocol for libraries and other county organizations. I do think that would be a good course or symposium or seminar. In the end, what you're asking for is very germane. And ultimately, Martinez, I'm sure you would agree, the key is, again, identifying what you are likely to face in the future and making sure we've learned from the lessons of the past so that we are more prepared. Now, the good news is I think there's a lot of articles that are coming out about how to do that. So I think that in terms of the field and the body of knowledge, that's going to be pretty well covered. Now, I think Patty's here. Good to see you, Patty. I'm pretty confident. I'm sure that probably the ALA e-learning portfolio probably already has that or will have that in the future. So
I'm curious in the last couple of minutes here, Anthony, back in the day when I was in library school, there's always this tension between, well, they're just giving us, you know, theory. I want practice. I want some more, you know, I want some tips. And some of the questions that we got here in the chat box here are about, give me some practical instruction on certain things. So how do you balance that, you know, in academia, the theory with the practice?
Yes, that's a great question. So I think that for faculty, one of the dangers always is that you could lose touch with the field. But the way we protect against that is we do research, and research means that we do contemporary literature reviews. We talk to participants in the field, and then we are involved in service ourselves, right? And so we bring that to the classroom. Now, if that being said, that's still in some ways not enough. So the other part that we always do is bring practitioners into either a class as a guest lecturer, or in the case of the iSchool, we get to work with Patty and Martine and other people that are leaders in the field doing it that actually will then teach our students, right? And so I think that certainly the iSchool is committed to anyone that wants to share your knowledge and expertise and can teach well. We want you. We want you as part of the portfolio. And so I think going back to one of the original questions, Martine, that is one of the things we're lauded all the time by students is, my gosh, you have a huge curricular offering. And that's all because oftentimes it's because of the practitioners so if the students want it, we can find a practitioner that can teach it. Right. So, yeah. And then the last thing I'd say, Martine, is kind of what I said earlier. Part of my job as the iSchool director is to be talking to you and Patty and other leaders in the field to understand what you see so that we can make sure that we have in the curriculum for our students.
Well, Anthony, we're going to wrap it up here. I want to thank you so much. It's been wonderful to have you share your ideas with us, not just about leadership, but also about the future of the profession. The iSchool is lucky to have you. California is very fortunate to have you back. CLA is also very fortunate to have you on their board. Look out, Anthony's in town, everybody.
And let me end with this. So let me tell you the ultimate determiner of taking this job. It's pretty funny. So the mascot for UNCG are the Spartans.
Yeah.
And the mascot for San Jose State were the Spartans. And I said, if that's not a clear sign, I need to take this position. So anyway, I look forward to work with all of you. As you can tell, I'm very committed to the field and very committed to working with everyone to strengthen that field. And so certainly note that we are committed, the iSchool, to ensuring that we learn from the field to make sure that we're preparing students, creating that pipeline to better serve libraries and the people that are important to us, which of course are the patrons. So
that's wonderful, Anthony. So Christine, I'm going to have you come back on, and we're going to thank everybody for joining us today. We have another session coming up in December. And I believe, is that, who's our speaker in December?
Ray Pun.
Ray Pun. And Ray is going to be with us on December 9th. Yes. So 4 p.m.
Martine, so
go ahead, Anthony. I'm
can
sorry.
I do a shameless plug? So next, let's see, we're Monday, November 29th. We are having our second Heritage Month Symposium celebrating Native American Heritage Month. And I'm delighted to say that our keynote is the assistant curator for the American Indian Museum of the Smithsonian. So we are going to record that as well. But again, that, Martine, is again, part of serving our mission is bringing people of expertise to the table to share their wisdom and knowledge with us. And it will be recorded and it will be put on our YouTube channel. So
can you put that date in the chat box here for us, Anthony?
Absolutely. Yeah, that would be Monday, 11/29. And it'll be on our website. It'll be from 10 to 12 Pacific time. And we've got a lot of wonderful panelists as well and leaders in the field. So.
Anthony, again, thank you so much. Christine, thank you for your support. And everybody, thank you all for joining us. We will see you next time.